Hello everyone, this is my Unreal Engine 5 implementation of Ghost of Tsushima Glass, plus some glass motion based on rotational dynamics. In the GDC presentations made by Sucker Punch Studio, the engineers did not tell how they made the glass motions in Ghost of Tsushima, so I thought I would make an implementation some glass motion based on physics. So I Google searched papers about glass motions and found one SIGGRAPH paper, which was also using bezier curve glass like Ghost of Tsushima. At first, my intention was just to implement the motion in the paper, copy and pasting the equation in the paper as HSL code. But, well, I ended up doing my own research. The problem I had with the paper is that I couldn't help but notice some mathematical errors and physical considerations omitted in the paper, which I didn't want to overlook. So I began my own research. I spent a few weeks studying rotational physics, writing down equations, mathematical equations over and over to come up with my own calculation method. Then I finally came up with my own algorithm to calculate the motions based on rotational physics. What you're seeing is the result of my research. And I think I've done a great job. The motions I have made works even at the presence of a strong wind force. If I add some motion that rips off the glasses and blow them far away, this would be more realistic, but I'm not gonna work on that kind of motion. I think at this point I could try to write an academic paper that could be accepted in SIGGRAPH, because what I have done is basically studying a SIGGRAPH paper, fixing its mathematical errors and making some different approach that covers some physical details not covered in the paper. So I think I can try, but I really don't have any experience of writing academic papers, so it would be some hard work to do for me. So I really don't have any specific plan for now. I may try. There are three types of forces involving the motion in my research and in the reference study, the SIGGRAPH paper. First one is the wind force. The base wind force can be adjusted using these three UIs here in each XYZ direction. And there is a random noise wind force. So this wind noise value is currently set to 1. That means the maximum magnitude of the random wind noise force is equal to the base force in each direction. And if I set this to 2, that means the magnitude becomes twice at the maximum, and you can see the increase of the noise here. If I set this to 0, that means there isn't any wind noise. All glasses are currently receiving the same amount of uniform wind force equal to the base wind force here. I have also added an option to visualize the wind noise force by turning this option on. It is all black now because there isn't any wind force. If I return this back to 1, then you can see the movement of the wind noise force. You can consider this movement as the movement of the wind. So in real-world physics, there is a linear relationship between the wind force and scale of the wind velocity. So I'm also making that linear relationship. So if you increase the wind force, you see the increase of the speed in the wind. The second type of force involving the system is the air friction. In rotational physics, air friction works as a damping force. It decreases the bouncing motions of the rotating object. So if I increase this air friction by adjusting this parameter here, you can see the decrease in the bouncing motion from the glasses. Air friction also has a linear relationship with the scale of wind velocity. So on a windy day, you would expect a high air friction, and on a calm day, you would expect a low air friction. So in reality, there cannot be zero air friction when there is wind. And this air friction should be adjusted together with the wind force. But I'm just making an independent air friction force for ease of testing. So at this point, when there is wind, if I set the air friction to zero, you see some crazy bouncing behaviors from the glasses. And if I remove the wind at this point, the glasses are still bouncing. It's because there is a third type of force working in the system, the restoration force from glass blade. It's the force that bounces the glasses back to its static position. But with the absence of air friction, it would take glasses forever to go back to their original static state. I'm making motions based on dynamics, so each glass instance has angular velocity, angular displacement that's kept in GPU memory and updated in GPU at each time frame. It's all done using Niagara, so all these glasses you're seeing now are Niagara particles. I'm using PCG, Procedural Content Generation, with NDC, Niagara Data Channel. So what PCG is doing, by the way, I'm using partitioned PCG with runtime generation. So what PCG is doing is that as I move the camera location, it's writing data to NDC so that Niagara emitters can read from NDC and spawn glass particles. You can see that over the, you can see the mountain over there, and if I move closer to the mountain, you can see particles are spawning, and if I move away from the mountain, the emitter is killing the particles. This, well, writing to NDC from PCG is a newly added feature made by Epic Games. You can use this feature by adding a beta version plugin, and you'd expect some errors and bugs. And I actually found one error. Whenever I try to write integer data from PCG to NDC, the engine gets crashed. So you should be somewhat careful if you want to also use this feature. When you're using PCG with static mesh spawner, PCG would do the generation and cleanup automatically, but when you're using PCG with NDC, the generation is automatic, but the cleanup is not. you have to add some process to Niagara emitter so that emitter can clean up the particles. In my case, I'm cleaning up the particle based on the camera distance between the particle and the comparison between the spawn time of the particle and the spawn time of the last generation time of the particle for each emitter instance. And one thing I'd like to tell is that if you're using NDC in island mode, NDC first looks for the location where the data should be sent to. That would be the grass position. And if there isn't any emitter instance at the position, the NDC spawns one emitter instance with some extent that's set in the NDC. So there are multiple emitter instances in this simulation. I'd like to make a mention about another YouTuber named Alex. He has a good video series about implementing Ghost of Tsushima grass using Unreal Engine 5. I also have borrowed many ideas from his videos, like this use of PCG and generating grasses at runtime. It's an idea I copied from his video. And I'm also using his grass modeling method. These grasses are just a flat square-shaped meshes, and material shader is using WPO to render the grasses with wedge curve. I just copied the material from his video and made a few modifications so that it can work with my dynamics motion. One interesting thing is that you can also use this simulation to simulate some underwater sewage. So if I set damping force high with more noise, then you can observe some underwater sewage-like motions. One thing I have done differently from Ghost of Tsushima is that I'm making grasses to have fixed lengths. In Ghost of Tsushima, grasses do change their lengths as they make motions. I can control the grass lengths because, well, I'm using quadratic bezier curve, while Ghost of Tsushima is using cubic bezier curve. Cubic bezier curve is a bezier curve with degree 3, and quadratic bezier curve is bezier curve with degree 2. When a bezier curve has degree greater than 2, there isn't any analytical function to calculate the length. You can only use a numerical method to calculate the length of the curves. So calculating length is a hard problem for bezier curves with degree greater than 2. In my case, I have made the equation by myself, the equation for length of a bezier, quadratic bezier curve. I first tried to do Google search because, well, I really didn't work on the calculation, but I couldn't find one, so I just spent my time, 3 or 4 hours, writing down the equation for the bezier curve length. The engineer at GDC presentation said that the length change was not really noticeable in their games, but the length change would be noticeable depending on the wind direction and the amount of the wind noise. Well, for example, at worst case, if the grass tip is touching the grass base, when the two end points of the bezier curve meet, the length becomes zero. So I will show some example video. It's when I removed the length control and let bezier curves just change their lengths as they make motion. It shows some tentacle-like motions. So like a Ghost of Tsushima, I'm using Voronoi diagram to generate regions of glasses. So glasses that belong to the same region share some characteristics like facing direction, joint position, and amount of static bending, the stiffness of the glasses. So the boxes you see here and there are just debug meshes from PCG. They are located at where Voronoi points are located at. But some characteristics like facing directions have linear interpolation between two Voronoi regions to make some smooth change. You can see there are some boundary between regions here. And they should form some gradual change of the facing direction from the center of the region where the Voronoi point is located at to the boundary. However, this linear interpolation does not always work because a region can have multiple neighbors, but I'm only making linear interpolation between two regions. So one glass measures its length to the Voronoi point of each region. That would be the nearest Voronoi point to that glass, and it measures the second nearest point. That would be considered as the nearest neighboring region. But that's not always the case. For example, in some big regions where the center is far away from the boundary, the glass can wrong calculation on the nearest Voronoi region, and in some cases it makes some split within one region. So there are different sets of the glasses in one region where each set is interpolated to different neighbors. So just using the linear interpolation between two regions does not always work smoothly, but I'm satisfied with current results, so I don't have a plan for fixing it. But one issue that I'm not satisfied with is that one thing that I should fix is that the missing shadow maps. Some glasses are missing shadow maps. If I restart this simulation, yeah, you can see the warning message at upper left corner. After that message shows up, some glasses are just not generating shadows. The newly generated glasses that are generated as I move my camera location may or may not have shadows. So I guess I should not use the standard shadow map to generate the shadows for the glasses when there are this many glasses covering a large area of the landscape. I should add some effect to the Niagara that could work like shadow. But I don't have any plan for fixing this either, so well, I may fix this in some future, but I don't have any plan for now. I have uploaded everything in my GitHub repository, this implementation, with a Readme file that covers great details on my research with math equations rendered from LaTeX. So please visit my repository if you're interested in this implementation and in my research. Thank you for watching my video. Bye bye.